do have a question that we'll start with as we move on into the ports, and that is serving port temperatures. Typical
port specifically?
Port versus table wine. Mm-hmm. Table wine is typically understood to be room temperature or maybe just a little cooler.
I mean, room. You know, that whole thing with room temperature was back when we didn't have central heat and central air like we do now. Mm-hmm. And most houses are warmer now than what they used to be. So, yeah, you want it a little bit below room temperature. Most people say, you know, depending upon the fullness of the wine, you want it a little bit warmer to show all of the complexity that's there. So you might be 65 to 68 degrees. Lighter reds, you know, a little bit less than that. And then into the whites, you're looking at your fuller whites around 60. And then when you get into the champagne, in order to keep the bubbles dissolved, that's going to be the wine that you're serving at the coldest temperature. But nothing's really coming out of the refrigerator at refrigerator temperature. All wine is to be served somewhat warmer than refrigerator temperature. And port, you're basically looking at a serving temperature very similar to what you would be serving a full-bodied red wine. You don't want it at 70 degrees or higher because of the fortification that's there. There's going to be a little bit too much alcohol that comes across on the nose, and that'll spoil some of the fruit that's there as well. So the temperature plays a role in moderating that alcohol content. I mean, it's an important element in the wine, but the warmer it gets, the more volatile that element gets, and it sort of masks the fruit esters that mm-hmm. are there.
Yeah, the it just overwhelms. Mm-hmm. Sort of. It's like one of those high alcohol zens for me.
Right.
It's too much, and
same thing.
I can't get there. Is port just dessert wine, or typical table wine for me? Like, I have what I call Tuesday night wine, which is wine I didn't spend a lot of money on, mm-hmm. That I'm going to have on Tuesday night, and I'm going to pull out a nicer bottle for dinner. Is port just dessert wine, or can port be a Tuesday night wine?
Port used to be in every time of the day wine. You know, it's funny, I was reading something the other day when I went to a tasting, and they had this, it was a liqueur actually, but, you know, a lower alcohol liqueur, and the history behind it said that it had been made for King George of England. It was a ginger liqueur, and it was to revive him and invigorate him on his morning carriage rides. So, you know, I mean, so when you
which we all need, right?
So, yeah, it's great,
all
you know?
Yeah.
So, to a certain extent, I mean, these styles of wines, we're drunk at all points in time in the day. And I think that...
And despite what the CHP might say, modern-day people should not enjoy a port on their morning carriage ride to work. Probably not a good idea in modern society.
No. But in Europe, port is often used as an aperitif. Again, to sort of get that, stimulate the appetite and get you ready for the dinner course that you're having. I think here in the United States, it's viewed mostly as a dessert wine, and certainly it pairs well with a range of dessert style of food that you can have, or just simple cheeses and nuts and things that you might have at the end of the evening. But I would not say that that's the only place that you can work with that. I think it does work both in front of and behind a meal. And we've even had winemaker dinners where we've taken port and put it in the middle of the meal, working with sort of some specialty types of foods. So I would say if you like port, experiment with it. Anything that you work, especially the red grape ports, if you're working with a sauce that's reduced from that port, that always helps with working it in.
It always matches it up. And the first one we're going to do here, we said, is this the California style?
This is
California
and
style.
Our fanciful name for this is Ruby, and that's just in reference to the fact that it's a Ruby style port, meaning a young port, barrel age on it, 2 to 3 years on average. And the grape varieties are those that you really think of when you think of the history of fortified wines in the state of California. You're looking mainly at Zinfandel, Petit Syrah, and Syrah being the principal varieties that people used to make port-style wines from. So we're paying homage to that history of fortified wine style for the state of California with Ruby.
Tell us what you like about this one here.
Oh, I love the raspberry notes that you get in it, and the complexity, I think, by adding the Petit Syrah that Steve did. We used to do just a Zinfandel port. which everybody really loves, mm-hmm. but a little bit more complexity and backbone from the Petite Syrah and the Syrah. I love how well it pairs with actually the cheese that down in Cabra. It's a wonderful pairing with this, and try to have people that come by the tasting room experience mm-hmm. the cheese and the port as opposed to just cheese and chocolate. So it's fun to watch people put both of them in their mouth, and the reaction that they get on their face is like, wow, I never knew that cheese could be so good with port, or port could be so good with cheese. So it's fun just watching people taste them and their reaction to.
Well, that's what we're going to do right now. As we move down the line here, this one's certainly more rich, mm-hmm. certainly more full-bodied. It's got a lot of depth to it. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming this cheese here, which I think, is it one of these
that's on
here?
Right here?
It's mm-hmm. this yep. one right here that's it's kind of gnarly looking.
It is. Natural rind, yeah. We call that.
Natural rind is yes. what we're calling this one. Tell us about this cheese.
This is a traditional English Stilton. So this is a big guy. He's aged naturally. As you can see, there's no wax on the rind. The air in the cave will create a rind on it that will allow it to age over time. This is kind of a big cheese, and what I love about this pairing is that it's in the middle of the lineup. And usually I think people assume that the blue cheese is going to be at the end of the lineup. And I love to put it in the middle only because I love a sweet on the end, and we have a sweet cheese to finish with. But I think it's
that's that reaction you were just talking about. Holy cow. Yeah, it completely changes that. And for me, blue cheese, I think you're either a total like blue cheese, gorgonzola, big cheese person, or sometimes it knocks people's socks off and they can't handle it.
I think you can grow into it, though, too. Yeah. It's over time. It's like drinking, you know, starting with white Zinfandel and then moving up to red wine. You know, you can grow.
And these kind of pairings, I think, help guide you into that appreciation.
Yeah. I don't know if I can even describe what those flavors are, but the way it changes and then just goes down, the finish of it is very silky. It's very almost smoking jackety, you know. Very Hugh Hefner-ish. You know, it just feels very sophisticated and rich. And
you got the girls.
Yeah, it's very, very good.